Thank you. Well, good evening. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you, Roddy, for that marvellous introduction. What an honour it is to be invited by the Director General of this great institution to moderate, to referee. I was told to referee, it's no blood on the canvas, 8-ounce gloves, 3 minutes each round. And I thought maybe there's just a touch of irony in the fact that migration and immigration played such an important part in what happened in this country on the 23rd of June, and the fact that I myself am an immigrant whose parents came to this country to serve in the armed forces in the Second World War and then stayed. And I emigrated from these shores in 1984, and those of you my vintage will know what a mess this place was in those 1980s to 84. Went to Switzerland because the company sent me, never imagined that I would be a migrant to Switzerland, and stayed 32 years later, as my wife keeps reminding me, how much longer are we going to stay here? And in that country, outside the European Union, outside the Euro, very successful, very competitive, and has been, as you all know, an enigma over centuries as to the reason why Switzerland succeeded. Now, that's enough from me. This debate tonight is called Brexit, as Roddy said, What Happens Next? And the title commands us to look forward, not to look back. But I'm sure we'll hear tonight that in order for us to understand what is forward, we need to understand the past. And we've got three experts to help us. Now, they come from quite different generations. And I sit somewhere between all three of them in that time frame. And I'm going to introduce them now, and not to tell you how old they are, because I don't know, but I'll simply introduce them by my estimate of the era of Prime Minister they come from. So I'm going to start with my guess that the youngest is Dr. Amelia Hadfield of Canterbury Christchurch University. She's a reader in European Foreign Affairs. I have to read this because the CV is detailed and very impressive. The Jean Monnet Chair, the Director of the Centre for European Studies, Director of Energy and Governance, and she's an expert on the EU, on security, on Russia, on energy, and she comes from what I guess would be Wilson Heath Phase 2. For those of you old enough to remember those days. Round of applause for Dr. Amelia Hadfield. The next panelist is Rupert Potter. He's a career diplomat. Now, during his relatively long, I have to say, relatively long career, because I'm coming to Sir Peter in a few moments. But he was the British Consul General in Vancouver, which sounds like a great job to have. He was the deputy head of the embassy in Bahrain, which also sounds like a great job to have. And prior to that, he was in Sweden as the political officer, and he was vice consul in Jordan. And in London, he worked on policy covering South Asia, Afghanistan, North America, as well as being seconded to the cabinet office, the International Institute of Strategic Studies, and he's very much involved with the British-Canadian Business Association and loves British Columbia. I've never been there, but I hear it's a beautiful province, beautiful province. My guess is that he is from the Wilson Heath era, Phase 1. Big round of applause for Rupert Potter. And now, Sir Peter Marshall joined the UK diplomatic service. This is an absolutely amazing story. 1949, Sweden, just the year after I was born. It's an amazing. Rising to become economic undersecretary in the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, deputy economic and social affairs, to being Britain's permanent representative to the United Nations in Geneva, 79 to 83. Commonwealth deputy secretary general, chairman of the Commonwealth Trust and the Royal Commonwealth Society, chairman of the Joint Commonwealth Societies Council, and author of many books, including Public Diplomacy. I guessed he was Ramsay MacDonald and Baldwin. Big round of applause for Sir Peter Marshall. We're an amazing company. Now, that's enough from me. We know who they are. They each have 7 minutes to set out their stall. I've got my egg timer iPhone 4 here, which records backwards to that 7 minutes. And they're all on their best behavior. They prepared their things very well. And we're going to start with the baby of the family on the stage this evening, Dr. Amelia Hadfield. And you've got 7 minutes to tell us the story from your perspective.
You never said anything about being on our best behavior. Okay. Thank you very much for that very, very warm introduction. When Sir Peter introduced himself to me, he said, you know, what do you do? And I said, I'm the director of the Jean Monnet Center. And he, without a beat, said, I met him. And I shut up. Right. We have a bit of a conundrum in front of us, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm looking forward to shedding some light on it. Leonard Bernstein once said that in order to do great things, you need two specific objectives. You need a vision and not quite enough time. So hopefully tonight we'll have not quite enough time. I find the hard, soft Brexit options that are beginning to float around difficult. I'd like to challenge us tonight to try to leave those aside. I find them an unhelpful, overly stark sort of binary opposition. I think what we're actually facing is a paradox. And the paradox is the following. If the UK moves further away from the European Union, it's going to gain political control, but it will lose the economic advantages of close cooperation. If it stays close, the European Union will undoubtedly seek a price, perhaps in the form of a budget contribution, maybe less tangibly in insisting the UK accepts rules set in the European Union, including its free movement rules as well. I'd like us also to bear in mind when we're talking about moving towards Europe, remaining in Europe, we're talking about membership in the single market or access to the single market. And it's a distinction that sounds a little bit arcane, but I think we do need to sort of draw attention to that. From my perspective, I'm interested in foreign policy, and happily, this is the least integrated area. It's an area where Britain has done a surprising amount of good, particularly in terms of bilateral relationships with the French. We've seen a lot of stark and clever and forthright work on security and defense. And the question is, what now? Will Britain continue to work with its European partners? I'd like to suggest that it's got three options. Some of you may have heard a reference to something called the reverse Denmark. Does that strike a note of what? And you must think, what the hell? Yes. So Denmark, obviously, you know. You're right. No, it's part of the European Union. Don't panic. That's fine. But it's not part of the common foreign and security policy. It wanted nothing to do with it. It felt it wasn't part of its sort of constitutional makeup. So although Denmark is a full member of the European Union, it has always kept it at arm's length, foreign policy. So Britain could flip this over and not be a member of the European Union, but remain part of the sort of foreign policy structures. So ticking the boxes of remaining in some decision-making modes, supporting some of the instruments, and moving ahead possibly with some of the policies. That's fine. I think that's one. I've got two more, Michael. Is that all right? Still on course? The middle road is, of course, an associated partner. And here, the Norway sort of option is being flagged up. Here, I think we would see more of a peripheral relationship, but still fundamentally in the club. So an observer member with regards to the Foreign Affairs Council, for example. Perhaps a case-specific participation, so participating in some aspects of EU development abroad or contributing to one of the larger educational programs, which these days counts as foreign policy, like Erasmus. And we've seen a lot of reference to this in the news, right, for example, Horizon 2020. Britain can kind of do this on a case-by-case basis, sort of deciding just how much further it wants to work with its European allies or sort of stepping back, depending on, obviously, if it ticks the national interest box. And then finally, of course, it's going to be detached. This is the furthest away. This sees Britain as an autonomous foreign policy player, determining its own security regime, charting its own course in terms of foreign policy. And here, perhaps, and we can talk about this a little bit more, there may be overlaps with other structures in the world like the Commonwealth. So the question, therefore, is which of these three ticks the boxes both of a political partnership with and also economic partnership with the European Union in a way that also allows the Brexit means Brexit sort of ethos, whatever that may be, to be dealt with in an honest and sort of tangible way. So that's the sort of stall that I'd like to lay out. My personal opinion is I think from foreign policy perspective, we want to see continued British leadership, because although we perhaps don't know quite enough about it, Britain has done an enormous amount of good in Europe, with Europe, and for Europe, and I wouldn't want to see that come to an end. Thank you very much, Michael. Cheers.
I think her middle name must be Rolex, because she was, you know, right on time. Now, Rupert, you're next, and set out the stall when you're ready, please.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. I have recently returned to the UK just over 2 months ago, having been overseas for 8 years, first in Bahrain and then in Canada. And I return to a country that, whilst it may not have changed, is a lot more visible and has become a very, very interesting place. The Foreign Office, in its wisdom, is very good at pulling diplomats back to the UK and into HQ to refamiliarise them with their country. And I have to say, coming back this time, I've realised why. Because you can become very easily disconnected, even though you can read about what's going on. So coming back this time, I feel very much immersed. I feel a bit like Bill Bryson, but without quite the wit, unfortunately, that he has, of observing my country. So I say all that because where I'm going to focus at least my initial discussion, and then when we get into the discussion further comments around what's going on within the UK through what I believe for me is a fresh pair of eyes, seeing it and immersing myself in it. The other aspect that I'll cover is how the UK is being seen internationally and how Brexit is being perceived, having spent 8 years overseas. Okay, only really became an issue within the last two, but within Canada, it was quite interesting. So I've got five conclusions, because I initially thought we had 5 minutes and I got my timing wrong, but I may need all seven. So five initial conclusions. They're very broad, but hopefully they'll open up avenues for discussion as we go. Firstly, I believe our society is going to remain divided for a long time to come, for years to come, unfortunately. It's going to remain divided not purely on the oversimplistic question of should we remain or leave the EU, but divided and pulled in a number of directions. We're divided by geography within the UK, by socio-economic groups, by education, and by generation, all of which you could crystallise into what are our views on globalisation and how is it affecting the UK. So I think those tensions have been there for a long time. Globalisation impact really only in the last sort of 20 years or so, you could argue. But the tensions that have been there have really come out as a result of the Brexit referendum. It's used the word magnified issues that already existed in your paper, and I think that's entirely right. So they were there before, but now they're out there. And discussion, I come back into a country that has never been discussing these things as intensely as it is at the moment, and I think it will do for a long time to come. Second broad conclusion, we have to respond to the concerns that were voiced through the vote, wider than them being about membership of the European Union. It's easy to dismiss. I can put my cards on the table as a Remain voter. I voted personally to Remain. It's easy to dismiss those who voted to leave as being misplaced, misled, misunderstanding the issues. There may be truth in much of that, but a lot of people who know what was going on also voted to leave. But the concerns I think that they have, again, very, very broadly around job security, immigration, identity, general economic well-being, independence, these are concerns that we need to address. If we address those, then we address the root cause of why, in my opinion, we voted to leave the EU. Two conclusions internationally. First of all, we are fortunate to genuinely have special relationships. I know this gets much debated. Does the UK have them? I believe it does. I believe for a number of reasons, partly the effort we put into them, but Five Eyes relationships immediately come to mind as a key example. Three of four if you include the UK, members of the Commonwealth. So the Commonwealth too, the Gulf, I certainly felt our relationships there were special. So I think we have those important assets as part of our outlook going forward internationally. I think we're very fortunate to have them. I think they're based to a large degree on history, our understanding of other cultures and environments, our ideas. I like to think our integrity and our competence, I still think we are respected. This all sounds very self-confident. I'll come back to this at the very end of my comments. But a key point on the how special our relationships are is we shouldn't misinterpret what special relationships mean. They don't mean we get our way. They mean we are trusted and we have access, and we need to use that access and trust. It's a terrible analogy, I'm going to use it anyway. My wife is my best friend. Doesn't always mean I get my way. But the analogy holds, I hope. We need, fourth conclusion internationally, we need to work those friendships and relationships very, very hard over the coming years. They will become even more important than they have been. We need to again engage, we need to push for agreements. We can do so with confidence. The UK still has a lot of reasons that it is attractive to other countries to have relationships with us. I won't go through them, but I can come back to them if need be. And it's not just a government job. It's individuals, it's culture, it's business. Everyone needs to be engaged. Final conclusion is the UK, whatever happens with Brexit, will remain an open, internationally engaged prosperous. I have to be wary how prosperous, we can get into a debate on that, but society. The reason I think that is the momentum is in that direction globally anyway, and we will go with it. Media, technology, travel, commerce are all too integrated to put back in the bottle, and we are part of that. And another reason is momentum is always with youth. Youth attitudes within this country and elsewhere are towards global engagement and integration. I agree, hard and soft descriptions are unhelpful. I think they create a nice picture for those who would seek to understand it, so as a way to enter the debate, but not as a way to resolve the debate, because they set up a win-lose situation on each issue, which I think is worrying. Finally, in case you worry I'm being totally utopian about everything and everything's going to be wonderful, I've also got on another page a list of the challenges I think we face to get there. It's going to be a bit like show jumping, where it seems to me I look at the show jumping arena and I think there are so many hurdles I have no idea how they remember which order to run them in. We're going to have to go over them all. Some will get knocked down, but we'll come out the end in some form.
Thanks a lot. Very good. Thank you. Yeah, very good. See why people made a fortune out of these ringtones. They're amazing. Sir Peter Marshall, the floor is yours, sir, for 7 minutes.
Yeah. But before it starts, I want the right of reply on Ramsay and Baldwin. Now, the Prime Minister whom I'm linked with... Stop that. The Prime Minister whom I'm linked with is Mrs. Thatcher. Because when the idea was mooted, my joining the Secretariat, she said, I don't think that much of that is an idea. The Commonwealth isn't an entity. My line was, even if it wasn't an entity, it's a reality. And I think during the course of the next few years, during which on one occasion she said, how's all that boring work of yours? I managed to convince her that the Commonwealth, even if she didn't like being lectured on South Africa, had very considerable merits in other directions, particularly on the economic side. Secondly, I want to say, in reference to what Roddy said, the word Brexitation, the great advantage of it is that if you translate that into French, it's Brexitation. And any French person will tell you that any French word ending in A-T-I-O-N can mean anything you want it to.
Now, you can see that we're in the hands of a skilled negotiator who's already taken 3 minutes. So, shall I press the button now, sir?
You may me press
okay,
the button.
Okay, boom, off we go. Yeah, yeah.
Now, there are four questions that we need to look at tonight, interrelated, of course, but probably best set out in this form. What was the real message of the referendum vote? How, as a democracy, have we hoisted that message in? How do we deal with the worldwide uncertainty which Brexit has created, and how do we fit ourselves to make ourselves, make a success of Brexit. Now, you'll stop me anytime you like after this, Michael. That's all right. Those are the four questions. Now, the point is that, to begin with, it wasn't a referendum said about whether we stay in or not. In proportions that we will never know, 52% of the population were expressing dissatisfaction not only with the EU, but with the whole of the way things were run in this country as a whole. Whether they were run by the EU or anything, but as far as they were concerned, they didn't like it, whether it was Brussels or Westminster. The point the voters were making was that there's them and us, and them are getting on with things to their advantage and our disadvantage. Now, second point is convulsions within the Conservative Party have served to produce with remarkable speed the Prime Minister, by far the best qualified as a political, among the political figures in this country, to respond to that message. Her first priority is, as she says, to fashion a country which works for everyone and not just for the privileged few. And if you start, that is absolutely the right starting point, and everything else really falls into place behind it. Now, the third question, during the referendum campaign, virtually every leader of the free world was urging us to stay in for fear of the way the boat would be rocked if we left. That, therefore, has created massive uncertainty. The immediate effect of that was a devaluation of 15% of sterling. But the question is that there appeared to be what in World War II terms would be called the phony war. Nothing very much seemed to happen after 23rd of October. Of June until last week when there was a flash crash. And that is just a reminder of what the uncertainties are and how they might be reflected. And we can be absolutely certain that in the years to come, there are going to be more of these. We've got an enormous task there. Now, we've therefore got to inspire our partners worldwide that we're a sound risk, that we know what we're up against, and that we're determined to tackle it, and that we are determined to remain, as you were saying, Rupert, just now, good, worthy, reliable world partners. Now, let us say that, or if we know what we are up against, are we fit to deal with it? And of course, the answer to that is a great, big, resounding no. There are two main indicators which illustrate this. The first is that we've had an overall deficit on our current account, the balance of payments, for every year in the last 30 years, and the deficit as a percentage of GNP is rising to a point where it's among the highest in the OECD country, and a sign. And nobody seemed to worry about this for years and years, but they're just waking up to the point. Secondly, the figure of our exports as a percentage of GDP is significantly lower than it should be if we're going to be people who can pay our way over the years. Now, those two indicators, totally unreferred to during the referendum campaign, are going to be governors of our liberty of action in the future. Now, So, what do we do? Well, the answer is the catalogue ABC. You begin for everything. What have we got to do as a people, as a community, as a state, as a nation? Welfare, education, apprenticeship, investment, infrastructure, paying fair wages, and above all, management. Now, this is the one word that I hope you will allow me to spend a little time on. The difference between an administrator and a manager is that an administrator keeps things going and a manager makes things go. And we've got all the administrators we need, and we haven't got nearly enough managers. Now, I could go on inevitably, but I would want to refer, and we surely will during the evening, the importance of soft power, the difference between power and influence. Also, how many people are economists here, and the concept of the J-curve, does that mean anything to anybody in this room?
Hands up if anybody knows what a J-curve is. Maybe a small number,
no.
So we'll have to explain.
Well,
that.
And we might come back to that later, but I mean, this is the picture that we're ahead of us, is of a J-curve, which is going down first, then you've got to make sure it goes up the other side. Well, now, how long will all this take? The answer is 5, 10, 15 years, nobody knows. But the answer is that doesn't matter. We've got to see it through. As Francis Drake wrote famously in 1587, there must be a beginning of any great matter, but the continuing unto the end, until it be thoroughly finished, yields the true glory. That is Brexit for us. And if we want role models, ladies and gentlemen, just wait until Monday, when in Manchester there will be a victory parade of our wonderful Olympians and Paralympians. There we are. My case is read.
There we go. Now, I'll come down. It's much easier sitting down standing amongst you than sitting up there on the stage, because they're the stars of the show. We've got two ladies with roving mics, Frances and Julia, just to see you over there. I just ask you three things, please, as you put your question. Remember the word question. Some of you will obviously want to make statements, even polemics, but remember, it is a Q&A, so please don't preach too much. Put it in the form of a question, even if it's just an Australian inflection. Put it the way the Australians do, the end of the sentence. Secondly, please tell us your name and your affiliation so that the panel have some sense of where you're coming from. Professional footballer, former diplomat, whatever you happen to have done, okay? And keep the question, if you can, fairly brief and to the point. And then we'll get through lots and lots of different views. I've been told to stop the show at 8:30. If you're all looking exhausted, I'm not going to give them 1 minute to sum up, because they might have changed their minds in the one-hour debate. If you're looking full of the joie de vivre, then we'll go on till 9:15 or 9:00. But once you can smell the food, I know from experience that people will want to start drifting to the door. Now, please indicate the first person who has a question, your hand, and one of the ladies will come forward with the microphone. The gentleman here, please. Microphone is behind you. If you could stand up so we could see you and tell us your name, sir.
My name is Andrew Ketteringham. I'm not quite sure what my...
So we can see who's aiming these darts at us.
Can we turn the house lights up so if anybody's dozing off, we can spot them? Instead of it being an Italian restaurant, it needs to be a Chinese restaurant. That's it. Very good. That's more like a Chinese Chinese restaurant. Now we can see everyone.
My name is Andrew Ketteringham. I'm not sure what my affiliation is, but apart from being a member of this club, I suppose I take some joy and a great deal of pride in being a part of a representative democracy. So I am outraged at the idea that whatever happens, if this government is to be believed, the deal will be done with the remaining members of the EU, and this parliament will not have a say in whether it agrees or doesn't agree. The irony of that is, what happens next doesn't depend upon those who wanted sovereignty brought back to this country, but in fact rests with what the remaining members of the EU are prepared to give us in that deal. So the question to you is, how do we turn that around and make sure that we do play a part in setting our way forward and give the British people a say in that, rather than leaving it to the remaining members of the EU.
Fantastic. And would you like to choose one of the three to kick off?
I don't mind.
You don't mind. Okay, Amelia, why don't you kick off? Please. Yeah.
That's not fair. I thought that was for Rupert. Okay. I don't know. That's a that's a difficult one about having a say on the outcome. I think that time has passed. That's surely, sadly, what the referendum was for. I think we're going to be following this sort of 6 or 7 month rather nebulous period, watching the May government set out their various stalls and come to a conclusion with regards to the sort of negotiations and the pre-negotiations. Can I concentrate just on the tail end of the question, what the European Union is going to give us? That's absolutely crucial. And May was quite right to start softening up France and Germany, even ahead of the elections there. And the Europeans are far more disposed to softening up than we are in this country. It's Canadian, by the way, the accent, if you're wondering.
Could you just expand a little bit on what softening up means? Just because it means different things in different cultures.
I think the understanding of that May basically said, certainly to Angela Merkel, we are divided between a hard and a soft spectrum at this point, between a strong and a weak sort of understanding. We would be prepared to concede the following if we know that we're going to be receive the following from you. And I think the same was effectively said to Holland, although with Holland we've got the migration issue in Calais and slightly more difficult things there. And Merkel was quite responsive to this, and a variety of other heads of state, including Italy's, Renzi was also responsive to this as well. They have no problem with the basic inclination and the basic orientation that Britain is going to be able to take. But how this reflects in terms of an active plebiscite, a way in which the country here, the people here, understand what's going on, I fear a gap. I fear certainly a gap in terms of the message of government going one way and us not really hearing about it clearly, honestly, and even legitimately. So I think there is a legitimacy question. I completely agree with you. I'm just not entirely sure what that intermediary structure can or should be.
Rupert, thank you. Rupert, and then Sir Peter. Rupert, just give a response to the question.
Certainly. You've highlighted what in my mind is a real tension within the system here, not just between the legislative and the executive, but the fact that within Parliament there is obviously a majority for Remain. At the same time, Parliament has to be involved in a process of realising an exit that they would not instinctively vote for. So it's a little bit, I draw a parallel, I hope it doesn't mislead, but clarifies between the hard-soft debate. The government has said Parliament will be involved in the discussion and that there will be consultation. Really the question is how much and when, and is that enough? I think I sense certainly from the two or three people I've spoken to about this, more early is better, but that immediately brings up the tension. Whether the government are being Machiavellian or whether they're being straightforward and saying we just need the space and we will honestly deliver you our thoughts, I'm not going to judge. But I think it's this tension that is the cause of the issue that you highlight. How we resolve it, that's easier.
Sir Peter, you've seen many, many parliaments. Give us your view on this particular situation.
I mean, I think this is absolutely the right question. And if you'll forgive me, I'll take a little time to answer it. And the first thing I say is, if any of you have ever seen a website called conservativehome.com, look at it tomorrow morning, because there is an article on precisely this point by your humble servant. Now, the situation is, in my view, is this, that under Article 50, the requirement is, and I quote, the Union, based on the guidelines provided by the European Council, shall negotiate and conclude an agreement with the withdrawing state, making arrangements for the withdrawal, having regard to the framework for its future relations with the Union. That phrase seems to be totally ignored by the government lawyers. Now, if you look at it in the context, it can only mean one thing, is that that framework should have been agreed before Article 50 is triggered. And if that were so, the right thing to do, of course, would be to present the framework to Parliament, if not necessary for its approval, for its information, and also, in my view, register it with the United Nations as a document of relevant wide international interest. Once that has happened, it will prevent the Commission and a good many other people from backsliding and trying to punish us for exercising our democratic rights. Now this is, it seems to me, this is where it comes in the question that you asked. What we're really talking about is not necessarily the rights of Parliament per se. What we're talking about is the prudent way of conducting relations for our withdrawal within the terms of Article 50. And you see the difference. I'm sorry for taking so long but I mean that is just about the answer to this question.
Thank you. I mean, these are complex issues, and it requires some time to explain and to peel away layer by layer. Anybody want to add a rider to the question from the gentleman there, or is there another question? Sir, please. Microphone's coming. Yeah.
Thank you. Charles Cullimore, a life member of the League and various affiliations, former, like Peter, former member of the Foreign Office. Just a comment that what isn't really being, hasn't been said explicitly, at least I didn't hear it, is that surely the government is in a frightful bind. I mean, they're about to go into a negotiation which will be exceedingly complex and difficult. And if you're going into any kind of negotiation, the last thing you want to do is reveal your hand in advance. But the more they give in to cries of Parliament must be sovereign, must have the right to debate this issue sort of now, I mean, you can't have a debate without being willing to answer some questions about what you're going to do. Mm. And I can well see why there's a great reluctance to get into that situation. Mm. It just seems to me to be, for the government, a no-win situation if they go down that road. I mean, that said, obviously, once the negotiations are ongoing and have reached a fairly advanced stage and they know what the outcome is going to be, no doubt there needs to be discussion with Parliament, but to do it now seems to me very difficult for that reason.
Do you want to come back on that, Amelia, regarding your experience of the EU and the way in which they look at this particular problem?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, Charles, thank you very much. I think you're quite right. There can't be a big reveal at this point because it risks, at least from the British perspective, giving away some very strategic understandings of how they want to play it. And again, having said we shouldn't have the hard soft spectrum, and like Rupert here, it's a good starting point. It's annoyingly persuasive, isn't it? It's very, very sticky. I think at this point, the European Union would really just prefer that Britain goes awfully quiet for 6 months. Britain goes awfully quiet.
Awfully quiet.
They're sick to death of the on again, off again, this is important, that's important, shall we? And the ridiculousness of last week with the, you know, let's have small and medium and even large size enterprise listing EU nationals. Oh, no, we're not going to do that. And this accidental announcement with regards to the London School of Economics suggesting that we're not going to hire any European nationals to advise the government, which is patently idiotic. I think the EU is kind of fed up at this point. They want to negotiate. They want to bargain. They're quite willing to compromise. But they would just prefer to be given a plan. This is the plan. You know, stop flying a kite. Just come back in a couple of months and give us a variety of options, even if some of them are difficult, unpalatable, unpopular. Europe is going through a serious time of its own domestic crisis. It's going through its own political convulsions. Nothing could be worse than this. So, in a sense, Britain can move Europe along because one of the key points, of course, is reform. And if we manage Brexit intelligently and sensitively, it will send a good message to Brussels to say, we're not happy with the broad, sort of overwhelmingly sort of elitist attitude that seems to come, even if inadvertently, from the vast bulk of the acquis, of the vast bulk of interlocking institutions. You can do better. There is a legitimate democratic deficit here. Let's try and heal that gap. And then from within there, with regards to where Britain chooses an integrated partner, an associated partner, or a removed partner, it has these options. And I think Europe is unwilling to let it go. Europe doesn't want to see Britain disappear, you know, even from within the peripheries. but I think it will listen, but only if the message is clearly and intelligently given, and not just a series of sort of media hysterical outbursts. So we need to be a bit more controlled and grown up about it.
Rupert, do you want to add to that?
Two very quick separate thoughts. One on the European side, they're going through each member state and the European institutions also having to go through the same process ahead of Article 50 being triggered, thinking, what do we want out of this? What do we want to see? So I think I would say this as a diplomat, a former diplomat, having the space and calm to think and develop and do it as well as possible is always a good thing. There has to be democratic accountability at some point, but I agree with what you say in there. The other pressure that's not been mentioned is that the government faces is through the media. If it declares its hand now in a very visible, concrete way, if that doesn't come out in the end game, they'll be panned for it. So they've got to also be very cautious about how much they reveal to the media, because, well, you've seen how much has been, every statement is crawled over at the moment.
So, Peter, what about the bind that Theresa May's in? It's a real problem.
The answer is, I'm afraid, you see, this illustrates the dilemma perfectly. If you think, what were a framework for our future relations? Let's dispute that we're talking about what will an independent Britain be wanting in the way of relations with the other 27. That is a much broader question than a negotiation between the Union and the withdrawing state on the modalities of the withdrawal. It's a subject not for negotiation, it's a subject for discussion. And what should really happen, and of course nobody's going to have, I'm afraid, the imagination to suggest this, there should be an intergovernmental conference between the 28 people saying, this is a problem we all face together. What sort of framework within which should we envisage the exact negotiation of the details? You've got to remember, of course, it's all these words in English and French and whatever, and I've talked about it just now. In French, the word for a framework is cadre, which is a much stronger word than we have a concept of framework in English. The word arrangements for withdrawal is modalité, which, of course, is a much weaker word. And the word for the guidance which the European Council is supposed to give to the lower orders and the Council and the Commission before it starts is orientation, a word ending in A-T-I-O-N, mind you. And that's another, a much broader concept. In other words, we've got to think of this not as lawyers and as negotiators, but as people who are looking at the future of the world and what part Britain has in it. Now, you see, Charles, I take half of your point, but only half of it. If we get an intelligent framework on the lines that I've just been discussing, that is something to which you can hold the 27 when the negotiations start. That will be the basis of the guidelines given, the orientation given by the Council to the Commission, which is right, so they're going to do the negotiation. Now that is, if we can draft that, this framework, we can. I mean, so I would begin by the framework would begin by saying, having regard to the preamble to the Charter of the United Nations, which means you should all behave sensibly toward one another and not try and punish somebody for exercising their democratic rights. I would also include, don't run the clock. I would also include all the texts of the major texts agreed by the United Nations in this anniversary year of 2015, especially the monster text on sustainable development. Now, I mean, this is where the situation is, that we think in terms of an independent Britain rather than somebody who's withdrawing from an organisation of great fallibility. It's a different picture entirely.
So, Peter, you open up a whole vista of interesting possibilities. There must be other questions that touch on this point. That, sir, please, and then the gentleman at the back. Microphone here, please. Thanks.
My name is Brian Hopkinson. To give you a bit of a perspective, I'm a retired investment fund manager. I spent most of my life going around the world looking at ideas. I've lived for the last 26 years in the States, so I got a perspective also from people over there. Last weekend we were up in Derbyshire staying with my retired brother-in-law, who's a retired farmer, and he voted for Brexit. And his reason was that he was fed up with the faceless bureaucrats in Brussels running his life. He had to fill in form after form after form for all the cows and sheep, etc., that he had, and he wants to get them off his back. The guys in Sunderland presumably voted because they didn't have many jobs, and the guys in Cornwall voted for other reasons. So there's a lot of reasons why people voted for Brexit. Politicians have a short view of whatever it is, 4 or 5 years, whatever the political cycle is. So the three Brexiteers and Theresa May will be looking towards the next election. Have they set themselves up to fail? You guys have been talking about the higher level, you know, what can we negotiate and what can't we negotiate. But the important thing at the end of the day is for Mrs. May to get back in at the next election. And what can she show she's done for the man in Sunderland or the farmer in Derbyshire or the guy in Cornwall to show that she's done what they wanted her to do at the end of the day?
Thank you. Thank you. Rupert, have they set themselves up to fail?
No, they've set themselves up with an enormous challenge, though, because they have 48% of people to try and attract as well who didn't vote to leave. So somehow through the mass of differing reasons why people voted to leave and the 48% who voted to remain, they have to corral enough opinion around the approach that they've taken or the eventual outcome, depending on when an election's called, to attract, to get them over the... to win the next election. They are fortunate at the moment that they have a Labour Party that's had to spend more of its time internally than dealing with attacking the Conservative Party. How much longer that goes on for or whether that's changed presents them with another problem. But it comes back to the tensions that I was talking about right at the start. They are so varied between geography, which part of England or which part of the UK you're from, what your socioeconomic background is, what your education is, what your age is, and somehow they will have to have shown progress towards an outcome that attracts enough people to vote for them. That has to be somewhere in the middle, otherwise it will be painted as one extreme or another. And I suspect politically, this is now pure conjecture, obviously, they will have to... except that they will lose people on either end somehow.
Amelia, how do you see it? Have they set themselves up to fail? I mean, this is not really what next, but we're looking a few years because of the fixed-term parliaments that exist now in the UK. It's not really next, but it's not that far away, and Theresa May must be aware of that.
It's not a particularly good comparison, but listening to May's speech a couple of days ago about going up the stairs in Downing Street and seeing the photos of the previous prime ministers, I'm minded of what Nehru said at the dawn of the new India in 1947-48. He said, "We have a tryst with destiny." And I slightly got that feel from Theresa May when she was sort of saying, we just once in a lifetime, you know, or not even maybe once in a generation do we get this opportunity. I hope that her purview is broader than simply re-election. I would hope that, I use the word hope, I think the stakes are so extraordinarily high here. If she buggers it up, she's going to go down like her predecessor, and they cannot afford a second one. Just in terms of negotiation, it has to happen twice, of course. We need a domestic package, and then it has to go through the route of negotiating that with the European Union. So what's going to happen in the next 5 or 6 months, of course, is the one thing that every politician tells you is good about government. We're going to be a listening government. So there will be some very serious soundings taken, because if there's no clear framework now, exactly as you say, clear cadre, there will therefore be an enormous policy vacuum. That's what we're looking at now. So the government will have to listen, and then having listened, it will have a variety of options in front of it from which you will have to judge. In political science, we call this ranked preferences, top to bottom, what do you like? And that will be the British package. And then on the basis of that package, they will have to bargain. They will have to bargain and they will have to compromise. And it will be different than the previous bargain where Cameron comes back and says, we got a good deal from the European Union. May will come up back and basically say, this is our package. This is the British package. And it will have that sort of historic, slightly totemic feel about it.
So, Peter, you've seen a lot of governments come and go. Have they set themselves up to fail?
I'm not sure that I'm in a position to answer, but I'm fascinated listening to what people say about this. I don't think I have any. I wouldn't say yes or no to what you said.
The gentleman in the back row, yes. You had a question. Yeah. Give the microphone, please. The microphone. Please start again. Start again and speak into the microphone, so we can hear you.
Mr. Jones, life member, Royal Overseas League.
Yes, thank you.
During the war, America was called the arsenal of democracy, where this country is the mother of democracy, and I fear myself that if we stayed in Europe, a lot of that would be eroded. Gradually, slowly, and we'd lose our identity and sovereignty, which of course the ex-Prime Minister was negotiating with Mrs. What's her name? Can't think of her name now. But Macmillan said too, that this country is no longer a great power, but we're a great nation. And I think we've got more to contribute outside Europe than we have in.
So, Peter, do you want to comment on that? Because you mentioned the sovereignty issue in your paper. You talked about the Clematley speech of being semi-detached. It's all relevant to that point.
The realm of soft power, yes. But I mean, again, I'm fascinated what people are saying, so I don't want to say any more. I've yacked enough myself.
But you have to, because you're a panellist. You have to respond.
Yes.
I mean, the comments there essentially that Britain's better off out of it. It's being diluted.
We have to teach our students that big, broad, heavy concepts like sovereignty tend to be thrown around a bit like an ideological hand grenade. You have to be very, very careful, where you aim it. Sovereignty is not, has not, will never be absolute. It is relative. It is always power in conjunction with those resting next to you. It's always, to some extent, interdependent, blurred, shared. It's not an unrelentingly hard concept, not even in law. I don't think, therefore, that sovereignty, British sovereignty within the European Union, has in any sense been diminished. Having said that, I think the political imperative sometimes has been quite absurdly squashed, and we may see some playback in that. I don't know about losing identity. I think I'm going to let Rupert tackle this one, because he's talked very quite volubly about the sharpness of our special relationships, and this to me predicates, I think, a sharp international sense of Britishness, and I think the European Union are pretty aware of British identity at this point. I think that's the sharp end of the wedge. So I'll leave
when you answer that, could you maybe just draw on your experience in Canada with Quebec? I mean, it's not an exact parallel, but I remember that there were two referendums in Quebec, and the second one basically killed the issue, because we have a question here about the SNP and the whole impact on Scotland and the United Kingdom. So not to really cross away from that too much, but in a way all these things are interrelated, as you said at the beginning, Sir Peter. Rupert.
They are. Yes. And I thought I had my answer down, and now I'm confused.
I messed it up. I'm sorry.
That's okay. It's added a valuable complexity to it. I agree on the issue of sovereignty and its relativeness. I think I'm going to separate out the EU from international. I think part of the issue with Brexit for those who wanted to leave was the view that by being one of 28, making a law that then affected us directly, we had 1/28th, and as a result, we didn't have total control, so we had given away sovereignty. Mm. And I think it's seen in that very simplistic term. So as a result, if we leave, we will take all that back, and we can just decide ourselves. There is a logic to that view. Unfortunately, those sorts of laws that affect the UK and affect the European other European member states. I think, obviously, I've told you at the start which way I voted. I think the benefits of being part of that shared sovereignty, shared, not given away, outweighed the arguable diminution of independent sovereignty that you can say. Separately, international. The UK's foreign policy is very distinctive. Sorry, I'm going to connect it with the EU. You're right, our identity in the Europe is well known. There's a common joke among other European countries whenever they're negotiating with us. They hear lots of nice words about how we're supportive of the general direction and the orientation, which is a great word. And they say, we're always waiting for you to say but. Because you always do, and then you always come up with what your independent separate thing is, and then they have to sit through that. So they know us very well. Independently, we bring that independence of view to our international relations as well. So actually, in the conduct of our foreign policy, whilst we can work through CFSP, a lot of what we do is independent anyway. So we have that increased degree of sovereignty anyway. And I think we need to use that. That's what we were referring to at the beginning, more than ever. Mm-hmm. Quebec.
Yeah.
I'll stop in a second. Quebec is worrying. I'm hesitant to draw parallels, although Quebec is worrying in terms of, obviously, the potential breakup of a nation in the same way that the breakup of potential breakup of the UK if Scotland were to vote for independence and have another referendum on the back of a changed circumstance. Again, I draw some faith that the most recent of the referendums in Quebec, although close, was largely won, you would know better than I, by a younger, more urban generation who wanted to see it remain part of Canada. Mm. I hope the same parallels operate here.
Good, thank
Those
you.
Those are my own personal views.
There's a gentleman here with a question, and then there, and then Roddy, okay?
Peter Valentine. I'm here as a guest, but I've got a question relating to the single market, really, and access to it. I've spent a long time overseas, and here in Britain and throughout the rest of Europe, we see imports from US, China, South Korea, Japan, everywhere. They all manage to access the single market without any difficulty. Why would it be so difficult for us to trade with Europe if we're not in the single market, in the customs union?
I think you're the one closest to the issue.
It wouldn't be. You just have to pay more, that's all.
It wouldn't be, you just have to pay more.
Yeah, they just had to slap a tariff on it. It's not difficult at all. And Europe would continue to trade, of course, absolutely. You would just be facing a series of possibly increasing ranges of tariffs and tariff barriers to a variety of goods and services. But what happens is the United Kingdom would suddenly fall into that international category of traders, and we would be able to trade with the European Union. It's just that we, not being in the customs union, we would not have the benefit of the dropping of those taxes, the dropping of those tariffs and non-tariff barriers. And that, for exporters, for manufacturers widely, is perceived to be a major economic problem.
Yeah.
It can do. Yes, it can do. It's not a major crisis, to my mind, actually. That's not the problem for me. That was not for me the main issue, actually.
So, Peter, you were drawing breath, or you were sighing, or I'm not sure.
No. May I intervene? In the last discussion, a Canadian friend of mine said, the British always land on their feet or on somebody else's.
I'm so sorry. Is that it, or is there... That's it, okay, okay. There's a gentleman... Some of the gentlemen over there had a question, please. And then Roddy's next, okay.
Thank you. Tony Smith, Commonwealth Garden Club member. I have a three-part question, if I may. And the first part, do the panel agree that Article 8 of the Lisbon Treaty, which, to remind everyone, mandates the European Union to have the best possible relations with its immediate neighbours, is a suitable riposte to François Hollande and others? The second question, principally to the gentleman in the middle, he raised a question earlier about getting to the true reasons for the leave vote, citing immigration, erosion of identity, smothering enterprise with bureaucracy, that kind of thing. May I put it to him that actually asking that question shows why he won't understand why we voted leave, because he didn't raise what I submit is the right question, which is how it is over the past 25 years, the political class in this country entangled us more and more in the European Union without the consent of the people. And my third question relates to... Sorry, excuse me. Well, perhaps just those two questions for now, since I may be taking up too much time.
Okay, no, they're excellent questions, and a glass of water maybe for the gentleman for the third one. Okay. Who wants to kick off? I think maybe you should reply straight away to that one. Yeah.
Given that the main one was, yes, related to something I said. Yeah, I like the use of Article 8. I think that's a good idea. Whether they'll take it in the same way, but I think it's a great idea. Entanglement with the European Union. You make a very fair point in terms of the perception of... it comes back to the sovereignty discussion, the perception of how much control we have over our own governance, whether it's health and safety regulations, whether it's human rights, whether it's immigration.
Can you speak up a little bit?
Sorry, if I'm going too low. I think actually they are all interconnected. So if I skirted too quickly in my opening remarks over the impact of the European Union on those issues, then I shouldn't have, because it is certainly part of it. Mm-hmm. So I don't mean to give the impression that the British public were unaware of the effect of the European Union and on our membership and how that works. Maybe that, in a way, is part of the problem of the Remain campaign and why it didn't work, so you could be on something there. But I do think that actually they are fundamentally similar issues, just looked through a different prism.
So, Peter, I have to ask you this question,
yes,
because you were an active and mature diplomat at the time of Ted Heath, when Ted Heath basically, if you like, took the country in. How do you see the fact that many British people feel that this is not the deal that they signed up to?
That's right. Yes. Can I deal with the first question, Article 8? You can hold the EU to be much more specific than that in the declarations of Nice of 2000, Laeken of 2001, and the 50th anniversary of the Treaty of Rome Declaration in Berlin of 2007. That is a much more specific undertaking to behave responsibly to the world in general, not particularly to the neighbours there. But it's worth something that's worth following through. On your second point, you are absolutely right, and this is where comes your question, Michael. The answer is that in 2000 exactly, the Treaty of Nice, the European community realized that they'd gone a long way forward and fast, a long way on from the Treaty of Rome of 1957, which we signed in 73 and came in 73, followed by the Single European Act, the Amsterdam Treaty, the Maastricht Treaty, Amsterdam and Nice. And what was called for in the Declaration of Nice was, if you like, a process of pausing for breath and stock-taking. And they laid out a provision for a whole consultation, the convention, a whole elaborate process of consulting people, and in the declared intention was to bring the institutions closer to the citizens, as they were called, the people. What happened? That convention was hijacked by Giscard and turned into a thing for promoting a constitution, the exact opposite of what was intended. And the spineless European governments went along with it. It was then put to the voters of France and Netherlands, who promptly rejected it. And at that stage, Tony Blair said, you know, we were living in an ivory tower and all that. But, of course, the zealots of Brussels, were they prepared to let go? No. They dished the whole thing up as a reform treaty, which eventually became the Lisbon Treaty. And believe it or not, the British government, in the course of 2006 or 7, roundabout then, said, well, you know, we'll go along with this, subject to certain red lines. And forgive me for a moment, biography. The Foreign Affairs Committee of the House of Commons considered the diplomatic implications of this, what became the Lisbon Treaty, and I'm glad to record me as saying with some emphasis, this is no way to conduct business, just leaving the field free to everybody else to profit at our expense. But did Mr. David Miliband? Oh, no, he said he thought it to be useful for other people to know what we thought. That's not diplomacy. Yeah. That's just weak need falling into others. What I've called, I'm afraid, in the past, not always to the pleasure of my former diplomatic colleagues, the Anglo-Brussels orthodoxy. The people have been preached for years and years. Sooner or later, you've got to go along with what they say in Brussels, and you might go along with sooner, because in case the thing has become less unfavourable later. Now, this bred in Britain the most basic feeling against it. The British people are, on the whole, slow to anger. Mm. But what must really cause them to boil is Europe, the behaviour of Europe, as particularly epitomised in the Lisbon Treaty and the way in which it was foisted on member governments because they said, this is a reform treaty, it isn't a constitutional change, so you needn't have a referendum. Now the Irish said, yes, we're going to have a referendum. And the referendum was lost. Okay. So the commission, acting on sort of what one would call the mafia, you know, made Ireland an offer they couldn't refuse. I won't go into the details now, but it's rather interesting. But all of this, people were saying 10 years ago, the next Parliament, House of Commons, would be the most Eurosceptic ever, and that was true of 2010. But not even more by 2015. I'm sorry.
Let Amelia come back on that, and then I know you wanted to have a final word. Then we have a question there from Roddy. Amelia, go ahead.
I confess to having a soft spot for the Lisbon Treaty because it's the foreign policy treaty, so therefore mine. Article 8, you can read it in two ways. It can be sort of foreign policy platitude, get on nicely with the neighbours, no kidding. Or I think it can be policy specific. The neighbours, the European neighbours, is not Britain. It's the European neighbourhood. And the European neighbourhood is a group of 16 states divided into North Africa and the Middle East, which is the Maghreb and Mashrek Mediterranean group on one side, and the Eastern Partnership on the other, which gathers all of the states from the Black Sea to the Caspian Sea. And the neighbourhood is the intervening buffer zone that, quote-unquote, protects Europe from the Sahel and sub-Saharan African perspectives beneath, which is development area, security area, volatile area, which they don't yet credibly have a plan for, and Russia. So get on nicely with the neighbours has come up quickly with a strategy that allows us to understand how we can deal with these. Don't forget to that 2008, 2009, this is Arab Springtime. This is a time when North Africa and the Middle East are literally going up in flames. And the European Action Service, which is, of course, a very strong, very good product, I think, of the Lisbon Treaty, has only a very limited response at that point. So I wouldn't want to sort of do too much damage, if I can, reputational damage to the Lisbon Treaty. But Article 8 is a clear sign that Europe at this point doesn't have a strong understanding of what quite to do with the neighbourhood, but it's clear enough on who the neighbours are and how best to deal with them.
Last word, Rupert, then we go to the next question.
Sorry, one very quick line, which touched on something you said, Sir Peter. I think the European Union, its institutions, and I think actually national governments, in national democratic governments, have never really resolved the democratic deficit and their ability to relate to their public. When that statement was made, I remember it, I'd forgotten it until you mentioned it, I remember the intent, but it's something that is never fully been managed to be resolved, and I fear it's going to get more acute because we are democratizing. So the generation that is coming through are expecting more direct say in what happens rather than less, and as a result, it's far harder for governments to satisfy those demands.
Ronnie, next question. Ronnie Porter.
Could I return to the topic of the single market, but come at it from the basis of a remark that Amelia made about the relativization of sovereignty, which I think is a really important point, particularly for someone like me who rather staked his vote to leave on the basis of my passion for the sovereign state, the national state, the nation state. But also pick up on a point Peter makes in his round table paper about having to consider all this sort of stuff in the context of the global village. Because you can try and take as much sovereignty as you wish, but if there's no permission to use it, your use of it will make you a pariah, like, for example, Russia over Syria or something like that. Now, one of the objections to the single market, or one of the most eagerly articulated objections, is that we do 35% of our trade with the European Union, but the European Union regulates 100% of our trade, and that's not fair. And you also said right at the start, which I think is also a good point, in terms of the relativization of sovereignty, that soft and hard Brexit definitions are unhelpful. Given all that, given our desire to have some control both over some political sovereignty, but to be able to trade globally, where do we position ourselves between the two extremes of hard and soft, particularly when you have high commissioners of Commonwealth nations who say the only prospect that Britain has to make a good fist of Brexit is by being outside of the single market?
Do you want to aim that to someone in particular to kick off?
To start with Amelia.
Yeah, Amelia? Okay, Amelia.
I'll start with the spectrum of sovereignty. I think it's very nicely laid out that you can have very hard, aggressive, territorially directed uses of sovereignty, perhaps as we're seeing now, very roguish uses. Russia's, I think, a very good example. And then an understanding where sovereignty is much more tempered and nuanced. And I'll cite Canada, if I can, and I'll cite a recent example when the Harper government was in power. The use of the word sovereignty, in particular in relation to Canada, riled a lot of Canadians because it's not part of our national identity. It's something that we found very deeply disconcerting. And when this was used relative to the Arctic, which for us is a very delicate zone, not just climatically, but also in terms of the First Nations in governance terms, I think the use of what seemed an overtly hard reference to an area that we weren't, we didn't fully have a sort of place for in our national imagination was deeply disconcerting. With Trudeau 2.0, I think there's been a complete reset, and what he's been very careful to do is to not use the word sovereignty and to talk instead about soft power, about influence, about diplomacy, about remaking a major Canadian brand like development policy and making that the vehicle for foreign policy. So I think the sort of permutations of sovereignty are terrifically important, and I don't know if the EU has quite figured that out, that with this sort of critical mass of sovereignty that they have, they can do an awful lot with it. And yet, in a sense, I think the sort of the economic taxonomy that's sort of come from it doesn't particularly help you. You've just got this sort of list of trade tariffs and trade barriers. And there is, I absolutely, completely agree. I think there's this sense of unfairness, you know, not just the trade tariffs, not just the trade ratios, but 100% of legislation versus 35% of exports. So where I would like to see Britain placing itself is, again, the sort of reformist dynamic, pushing the European Union to reconsider itself, to think better, to not have such a overtly heavy approach to legislation. It must be more plebiscite-based. It certainly must be more civil society-based. The idea of a convention-driven treaty, that to begin with, you're absolutely right, that was the right sort of dynamic. And I think in order to engage the youth as well, who are clearly going to be the very next range of 450 million voters across the European Union, that's important. Customs union, I'm a little bit more pragmatic on. I think Britain can afford to think a little bit more robustly about who it chooses to trade with. Maybe Canada.
Okay. Sabina, you mentioned in your paper the important role that Britain had played in the development and the creation of so many of these institutions, particularly after the Second World War. How do you see that in the context of Roddy's question?
Yes, I mean, it's quite... You see, a point about all of these things, the major, the UN, the World Bank system, everything, is that... If you're going to agree that something is better done collectively, you have got to give the secretariat, you transfer to the secretariat competence in that area, and you agree that if there's disagreement between the two powers on that particular area, then an impartial body must decide which is right. Now, that works all right in the UN because of the International Court of Justice. You want to agree that the issue be referred to them. In other organisations, again, it's a question of negotiating there. But in the case of the EU, it's a special case because the construction of the Treaty of Rome, the whole idea of building the Europe based on the coal and steel community, was that you would really transfer rather more to the central thing, and therefore the central power, as adjudicated over by, in this case, the European Court of Justice, therefore appears to loom rather larger than it would in any other case. But in fact, in terms of, strictly speaking, of sovereignty, you haven't ceded any sovereignty. You have, in your sovereign status, agreed to transfer competence to the body in question, and that you agree that as they exercise that competence, you will respect international judgment on how that competence is being respected. Now, that can be translated emotionally into the ECJ tells us what to do. But, of course, the ECJ tells everybody what to do within the area of competence transferred to them. For the rest of it, that's strictly for the birds.
Mm. OK. Rupert, just finish off with your point on that.
One very quick final line on... customs union and access to the single market and what happens now. Regardless of how this comes out, what I hope we'll see is British businesses will look to wherever the tariff and non-tariff barriers are best suited to what they do and go to those markets. It will take some attitude shifting, I suspect, in some. Some are already there, some are very internationalised and will move accordingly. But there will have to be an adaptation and a responsiveness among business as well, however this comes out. I obviously hope that it comes out that we have access to the single market and that actually we continue unimpeded and everything is very smooth. But if it isn't, then looking to those other markets becomes even more important. But that's the response is largely down to British business and they can be preparing for that now.
Let me just come to two questions which came in by email specifically. Maybe I'm not sure if one of the people who sent this, Dr. Alexander Farquhar from Oxford, if he said, I'll read your question if I may. Yeah, of course you can, sure. Why don't you take the microphone and put it differently, please, please.
Yes, thank you very much. My question contained the phrase hard or soft Brexit. And one of the great things about tonight, which is pushing me towards a reconsideration of where I might stand, is this idea of the gamut of possibilities, economic possibilities, political possibilities as well. My question originally, with a minor adaptation, we almost touched on it, and then to my dismay, we departed from it. And I'm partly standing here because I attended a very similar event at another institution not very far from here. And in that entire night, Ireland was never mentioned, and Scotland got one brief mention. This evening's been much better because we've actually only heard one slight slip of England rather than Britain. And we've mainly stuck to the idea of the UK and Britain. But really, I am very interested to see how the panelists feel about the way in which things are moving. I'm drawn to the Herald's, the newspaper in Glasgow, the Herald's editorial last week, which said that the Prime Minister's speech was pushing Britain not just towards an economic crisis, but towards a constitutional crisis. And I'm very interested to hear what the panellists feel about this movement at the moment, where we stand. Perhaps it's a rationalisation of the best possible position, but what effect do you think it will have upon this increasingly, I think, fragile Anglo-Scottish Union?
So Brexit, what next? What effect? So Peter, you please.
Well, can we begin with the Irish? But I think it's the same. You're absolutely right. The far the most important thing in this exercise is to keep the Union, the United Kingdom, and of that Union together. And if we, the idea of doing anything, negotiating, which puts that in danger, seems to me to getting our perspective and our priorities wrong. Now, it's the exact relationship between keeping the peace properly between the constituents of the United Kingdom and exactly how we deal with Brexit are slightly complicated. But that's what you have parliamentarians and politicians to deal with. But the priority, I think, is of absolutely no doubt whatever, and that is you keep the Union together. Any deal we did with the EU, which put that at risk, is, in my view, not worth having and should be rejected.
Good. Rupert?
I had it when I referred at the very outset to my list of challenges. That's one.
Yeah.
The nature of the outcome and its potential impact on the Union is a key priority.
Mm-hmm. Amelia?
Yes. I think keeping the Union together, obviously, at least in terms of a consolidated bargaining actor, makes good sense, but there's clearly an enormous amount of tension rising now between Messrs. Sturgeon and May, and I think I get the sense that May feels confident enough that Nicola Sturgeon will just keep shtum, that she's just going to have to like it or lump it. They've already told her in no uncertain terms in Brussels, you can't come out and negotiate separately, forget it, that's just not an option, you can't do this sort of regional breakup thing. So I think the only credible option will be to look at the regional dynamics across Britain, which include big chunks like the southeast of England, for example. And as you say, with regards to business, take a intelligent sort of portfolio-driven approach in terms of how Brexit is going to impact these areas and see if we can anticipate what the risks are, identify what the opportunities are, and craft that together into a genuinely British ask that reflects a good package. With regards to Ireland, obviously, I mean, the border issue is absolutely crucial. The day after the referendum, I had, I think it was 16 separate interviews across Canada. That was wonderful. And every one of them asked about Ireland. Mm. So you're loved in Canada. Don't worry about it. security border, but also the Irish economy. the sheer amount of trade between North and South Ireland. I think this is something we tend to...
It's a huge amount.
We are hardly mentioned in the referendum at all. Yeah. Now it's going to be a vital issue. Thank you for mentioning it.
Yeah.
It's really instructive. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? I've got one more question that came in. But please, sir, let's get the microphone to you. Yeah.
Thank you. My name's Listra Riches. I'm just a recent member of the League. What I want to ask all the panellists is this. How long do they think the European Union will last? I can't imagine it's going to last very long at all.
Okay. You've answered your own question, but we'll ask them. Anyway, who will it? How long, Sir Peter? Sounds like a song, a love song, doesn't it? How long?
Yes. One look for some sort of diplomatic evasion of the problem, but the answer is nobody knows.
Nobody knows. Okay. Rupert, how long? How long do you give it, the Union?
I agree, obviously, nobody knows. I tend to think it will hold, though, for quite a while. I think the centre will hold.
Okay.
I think it is under great tension.
Okay.
But it's gone so far down this track. Not forever.
A terrible beauty is born. Yeah. Amelia, how long do you give it?
I think I'm allowed to maybe quote Jean Monnet here, if I may, that Europe is born of crisis and tends to refine itself through crisis. That's not a great recipe for progress. I would suspect that, I think you quoted Yeats, is it? The centre will probably hold, but it's going to have to be radically reformed. Otherwise, bits are going to drift off, starting with France. And I can't say this without a swear word, so I won't. Messrs. Le Pen, who have clearly, I think, a particular view to breaking off in sort of tribalist methods, bits and pieces. But the Visegrad group as well.
The where, sorry?
The Visegrad group,
yeah.
Slovakia, Poland, Hungary, and the other one. Luxembourg even. I teach in Luxembourg from time to time. I'm astonished at how Eurosceptic my own students are. They're very unhappy, don't feel at all that they're being listened to.
In Luxembourg?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Holland as well. Mm. So we're seeing, I think, a wave after wave of Euroscepticism. This was a driving force of the referendum. We need to listen to it. Europe needs to listen to it.
I have a question here from Jill Bingham. It's a very specific question. We really haven't addressed it because we've been looking at other issues, but it's very much a looking forward question. She asks, what effect... Is Jill Bingham in the audience? Jill, do you mind if I read, or would you like to... May I do it? Yeah? I'm sorry, I should have asked. What effect would a hard Brexit have on the UK economy? What effect would a hard Brexit have on the UK economy? I know we've discussed hard and soft, but it's a legitimate question because most of us out there really don't know what's going on.
Why am I always first?
Because I lean to the left. I lean to the left.
Never sitting on your right again. I'll run the flag up the flagpole a little bit.
Please do.
At Christchurch, we're putting together what I thought would be a fun little project, and I now infinitely regret. It's a sector-specific appraisal of everybody in Kent. Madness. Trying to gauge economically how bad it's going to be, and rather like an undergraduate essay, it's a bit uneven. In some areas, like tourism, very little has happened, and yet we know that vast amounts of European funding go to support European tourism, British tourism. So that's a sort of mid-range issue. Agriculture in Kent is going to suffer very, very dramatically. Upwards, at least from the figures we've got, of 90% of the small farm holdings in Kent will roll over in the next 5 years. And that's a decimation. Absolutely. Other areas like healthcare, you think, yeah, it'd probably be okay. But when you see the number of European Union workers, high-skilled European workers, who, even if they've been welcomed, may not feel welcome, I think that's another impact. Rather than hard and soft, I think I'm looking at the short term, the medium term, and the long term, and I'm looking at it in a sector-specific way. That seems to me the kind of the map that I'm able to put together at any rate. Thank you. It's a really valuable question.
Sir Peter?
Yes, I mean, I think it's a fascinating question. The impact would be differential according to whether you see the view that foreign investors take of what it is that's worth taking a risk on and so on. And that would depend on the degree of devaluation. Yeah. I think this morning the Treasury are sticking by, are they not? They reported this extraordinary estimate they made, which was caused a row with George Osborne's emergency budget, each household being worth 2,800 less or something over a period. But I mean, the answer is it is absolutely incalculable. And it would depend, of course, how much confidence people had in us that we had got our act together or were getting it together. It isn't a question you can answer sort of in relation to the present circumstances. You'd have to think of as what is the British government or the British people doing, getting their act together while all this negotiation is going on.
Mm-hmm. Rupert, just to wrap up on that one.
Yeah, there will be an effect. It will be negative. My calculation has been knocked slightly downwards by the sort of discussions you're having. But it won't be, obviously existential is too strong a word. Not absolutely catastrophic is what I mean by that. In large part because certainly the investors I use anecdotally that we've spoken to, some are put off if we lose access to the single market, but a lot are still interested in coming to the UK and investing in the UK in any way, and I agree a large part will be how much that faith holds up. Our financial services sector, for example, I think London, again, we may see some drift out of London to the likes of Frankfurt, but it's not going to collapse. It's of sufficient scale and it's sufficient globally integrated that it's going to be okay. It's really about the scale of the damage.
Set up in London after the
referendum.
Speak
up a little bit for us.
450 new companies set up in London after the referendum.
450?
That's the good news.
Okay. Yeah. Now, look, we've passed our first finishing line, but there is a second finishing line. It's past 8:30, but there's a question from this gentleman and from the other gentleman, and this, not to be divisive, but this has been a rather quiet side of the room this evening. Any more questions over there? The lady there, yes. Third question there. So, fourth question, great, okay.
John Aykroyd, a retired member of the Department of Trade and Industry in London and also a long-standing supporter of the Commonwealth. Do you think there is anything that the Commonwealth can do or offer the United Kingdom, either overtly or covertly, which could possibly strengthen the hand of the United Kingdom in its negotiations with the European Union on Brexit? Thank you.
Should we go to you?
Oh, no,
we go to
certainly. Yep.
Wait a minute. You have the long view on the Commonwealth.
Patricia Scotland has spoken up very, very strongly on this subject. She said the Commonwealth will be turbocharged demonstrate the possibilities of dealing with Britain outside the Commonwealth. And as you know, the Commonwealth trade ministers are going to meet in the UK next year, and Commonwealth heads of government are going to meet in the UK in 2018. Now, a lot could happen between now and then. True.
I think of potentially great support outside. I'm not sure how much leverage inside, but I defer to greater expertise.
Amelia?
Not a whole lot, to be
honest.
Not a
whole lot, okay.
No. I think you're going to see the rise of Commonwealth-induced bilaterals, Canada, for example.
Australia.
I'd like to continue to see the Commonwealth as a source of good practice, though, with regards to the sort of collectivity of influence and power, and I would like, you know, to see that roll over into British foreign policy.
Okay, thank you. The gentleman there, please.
Chris Kortrek.
Speak into the microphone then.
Chris Kortrek, I'm a member here and analyst. One thing that I've completely sort of missed tonight out of the whole discussion is how Brexit will actually affect the British overseas territories. So the way France, for example, is actually conducting some of the funding from the EU into British overseas, into their sort of territories, you see the same thing with UK occurring, actually, with EU funding actually leaving Europe and ending up in British overseas territories, funding various conservation projects and loads of other things on these islands. So how do you see the impact panning out over the in the British Overseas Territories?
For those of us who may not have it on the tip of our tongue, you're talking about Cayman, British Virgin Islands, not the Channel Islands. Not the Channel Islands, okay.
Gibraltar.
Cyprus. Yeah, exactly. Turks and Caicos Islands, fine. Okay, thanks. Yeah. So Peter, can you kick off?
Well, I think the answer is, of course, this is going to be a vital part of it, and we've got to make absolutely certain that all parts of the United Kingdom, or for which we're responsible, are properly handled and looked after in the negotiations. I mean, it's a very important, because Gibraltar, I suppose, is the key one in this instance.
Sorry, Amelia, do you want to just...
The British Overseas Territory is in receipt of European funding, like regional development funding or structural funds or even development funding?
Well, I can say we had the Minister of Finance from Gibraltar in Geneva just last week doing
and
a stomping
So if door. They are, obviously, you're going to be looking at a rollback on that, and whether it's repatriated, you know, through Britain and then doled out again, that's certainly a very key question. But if they're in receipt of, you know, structural funds that... are accrued to 30 or 40% of the annual budget in that area, that's going to be a major change. So that's a very valuable question. Thank you for that.
I would simply roll on from that answer that that's part of a resource challenge that we face as a result of potential repatriation of funding. What do we do with it? Where does it go? We still have to sustain and work with the British Overseas Territories.
Exactly.
Okay, thank you. The lady here, please. Sorry. Could you repeat that again? Sorry, I was talking and probably interrupted you. Say again.
Is there this potential that Britain might have to receive another IMF loan as a result of this?
I doubt it. I don't think there'll be flavour of the month at this point. Although I'd like to see them try.
No.
Yeah. I don't know.
Mum, please.
Hi, my name's Diane Hamilton, and I'm a member. I work in the charity sector, and I work with... Many people I know in the sector work with vulnerable people of different nationalities who've experienced xenophobia since the Brexit vote. I'm wondering what the government can do to stem the tide to those types of activities happening. People who've, you know, I know people have worked with people who have been attacked for their nationalities since the vote. I'm just wondering what your views on how we can stem the tides of those sort types of incidents.
The rise of xenophobia and anti-immigrant sentiment in this country.
I think this is one of the most distressing parts of the... it really is. In other words, whatever the objective arguments are, one side and another, to the extent that the campaign has had this result of appearing to increase these things, it really is a minus and, of course, a very bad factor in, if you like, our soft power. I think it's a terribly sad aspect of the whole thing, but I do believe, I have a very strong faith in the British people, and I don't believe this is a permanent factor. I think this may be something that has... immediately around the campaign itself, that I hope it will dissipate in time.
Ruben, what do you think?
I share that opinion. I think it should be disassociated even with Brexit voting because a lot of very good rational reasons for voting for Brexit. And so the tragedy in a way is both the association in that respect and also association with the UK. The government's been very clear. It has no tolerance for it. I agree, most of the British people have no tolerance for it. All we can do is be robust in countering it, both domestically and overseas.
Amelia, it's a sensitive point. Huh?
It is. I'd like to be able to sort of unpick it from Brexit, but the fact of the matter is Brexit acted as an incredible catalyst for it and a supreme social magnifying force. I'm sad to say that in Canterbury we've had a variety of violent episodes, including staff and students of both of the universities there. And the county council came out, and the police came out, and also the university communities came out, actually led by the students, which was really good to see. And it was rights and respect and the idea of the sort of Canterbury fabric not to be sort of picked apart by divisive and distressing and frankly degenerative social attitudes like this. So there, it has been distressing to watch, but we're beginning to see, I think now, much more positive, much more productive attitudes locally. I'd like to maybe speak to you later about it. I think we've seen a variety of some nice bits of good practice in that area. So, yeah.
Could I add just one thing? That Canada has a record in all its race relations, everything second to none. I think they are marvellous.
There you go. She's blushing. She's blushing. The gentleman there. That's right. Yeah.
Good evening. I'm Richard Henry. I'm a member of the League. What impact does the panel think the president of the commission have on the, because of what I perceive his attitude to be, or it appears to be from the press, have on the negotiations, and how, if it's as negative as his early indications gave, can that be controlled?
It's the former Prime Minister of Luxembourg we're talking about. Yeah, as you mentioned, as you had brought up Luxembourg in your student, you have a point of view on Mr. Juncker.
Yes, he is a colourful figure, that's colourful. For sure. I think there was a lot of tension, and I'm sure Sir Peter will know better than I, about the sort of turf war as to who is supposed to manage the Brexit negotiations. Is it going to be the Council, the Commission, or the sort of intervening actors like Corrapeur, for example? We now know, of course, it's going to be Barnier, who was not a universally popular choice. I think Juncker is going to have to allow himself to step back from this. In a sense, it's not actually his role. If you look at the State of the Union speech that he gave a couple of weeks ago, Brexit is not mentioned at all. It's not one of the top 10 European Commission objectives for this year. And it was not mentioned explicitly as a strategic initiative of his personally. This is not to say, obviously, that the Commission is not going to try to have actively, when Britain finally rocks up to Brussels, a guiding hand in how those negotiations go. But I do hope that Juncker is aware that he doesn't have the best of reputations in the diplomatic sense, particularly not in this country. He's not well loved or well liked, and his presence will, I think, be seen fairly deleterious light. So I hope that also the new British Commissioner, Julian King, I think will, in counterpart with Barnier, be able to move on. I think a British profile here. King's going to have to be careful. He can't play the British card too much. Obviously, when you're hired as Commissioner, you're supposed to take the European interest. Interesting that he's been put in a supremely strategic position, and that is to manage the emerging European Security Union, which will be of real interest to Britain's future medium and long-term relationships with the European Union, and that will far outlast Mr. Juncker, hopefully.
I would just add, there are multiple PowerPoints within this. I'm no expert in which of them has the strongest pull on the various levers and the various aspects of the UK exit. There are the occasional unhelpful voice, and then there are others who may be more sympathetic. So I wouldn't take the odd statement too seriously on its own. I think if there's a tide, then we have to watch that.
Do you have a final word on Mr. Juncker?
Yes, I do. It's a very good question, and it's not only Jean-Claude Juncker, it is Martin Schulz, the President of the European Parliament.
Yeah.
Now, the question is this, that they may all be sweet reason until the negotiations start on the basis of the guidelines provided by the European Council, when the person in the driving seat will be Jean-Claude Juncker, dealing with the representatives of the UK and other powers, but in the framework of the Council of Ministers and not the European Council. Now, what I would say to you is, if it's possible to reduce the risk and not simply rely on a hypothesis, then do so. That is why I want to see the framework agreed in advance, because then it would be impossible for Juncker or anybody else, as it were, to undercut the framework. And that, is, I think, is the specific answer to your question.
I think we've sort of seem to run our course this evening, and what I'm going to do is ask the three panelists if they're up to a one-minute summary. In your case, that would be 1.5 minutes, just to allow, just to be entirely consistent through the evening. And I know you won't speak to me again after this evening. And then, after that, I will try to draw things together, and I think I can smell the kitchen, even if you can't. We'll go and have some dinner. How does that sound? Yeah? Amelia, why don't you kick off?
I'll be very brief. first of all, I'd like to thank everybody for coming tonight, and the questions have been exceedingly difficult and challenging, which is great. It's a good evening. I think for my part, I'm going to take the educator tack. I'm going to continue to look forward to teaching the European Union to young British students, because it's not going away. We're going to negotiate a variety of different sorts of relationships. Some will be very painful, some will be very annoying, and some I think will be very fruitful and very rich. I continue to want to take students on field trips to Brussels and to other European capitals and to show them the power plays and the economic dynamics and the social variations of Europe. And I don't want to ever let them forget that we're all heirs of European culture. And that's an extraordinarily long game. And I don't want to see Brexit as anything more than a blip, if that doesn't undermine too much what we've been talking about tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Rupert.
I would echo the thanks for the questions. They've been diverse and challenging, which has been excellent. As you can probably tell, I tend towards the optimistic view that things will be fine, both for the UK, most importantly from my perspective, but for Europe as a whole. That said, I think we've highlighted a lot of the challenges that are in there when it comes down to the reality of realising my optimism, one of which is a theme that has come out that I'd add to my conclusions, which is around democracy and democratic expression, whether it's through Parliament, whether it's through young people feeling their voice hasn't been heard, and increasingly direct democratisation, whether it's through the lack of ability to communicate what is going on from the centre, whether that's Brussels or London. I think that I simply mention it in my conclusions because I thought that was an interesting theme that came through the discussion this evening. But as I say, I'll flip back to overall, with challenges, optimistic.
Sir Peter, last word.
Love listening to my fellow panellists and to the questions you ask. And I'm not going to file any complaint against you, Michael. That's all you're going to do.
That's it. My gosh. Well, I thought you were going to say something else. We're going to show our appreciation. I suppose I should sum up by saying it seems to me as the outsider, I've lived abroad. I'm here often. I have brothers, sisters, children, grandchildren living here. I live in probably the most European country, speaks three of the languages. It's complex. It's successful. I'm extremely proud of Britain. Britain will find a way through. It will come out, but the key things are reputation, keeping promises, and the point you made in your paper that particularly now it's a service-driven economy and not a manufacturing economy as in the 50s and the 60s, that the way in which you behave towards others is critically important. And I have 110% confidence that Britain will come through all that. Thanks a lot. Thank you, panellists. Thank you, audience. Bon appétit. Thank you, Roddy.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Okay, good.